Hi, everybody. Hi, friends. Hi, Shakespeare friends. Hi. I'm Melinda Hall, and I am your Shakespeare relay MC. So this is a crazy idea I came up with. I hope you all have fun. So basically, may I invite the Shakespeareans to the stage, please? Come join me. So you have 60 seconds or less to perform any Shakespeare you want. So it could be a song, a poem, a sonnet, a line, a monologue, an entire play, doesn't matter, but only in 60 seconds. And if you go past 60 seconds, you get, Kate, come here. If you go past 60 seconds, you get the whistle of doom. Yeah, you don't want to hear that. So keep your time limit. So hunch together, you're all friends now. Friends in the terror of performing Shakespeare on the stage. And again, there's no rules. You can do any piece you want. Come on a little further if there's more. Or we can do, we can make two rows and jump in and out. So here's the other thing that might earn the whistle of doom. Yeah, come on up. Is if there's too much dead air. Say I finish my piece and I go back into the line and the next person's supposed to go and there's a lot of dead air where they're like, hey, I don't know, should I go? What should happen? I don't know. What am I supposed to do here? Then I should be hearing, which is the equivalent of the wah, wah. So that means you missed your turn. So we have a lot of people to get through and it'll be a lot of fun, but you gotta just go fast, okay? Everybody, gotta say it fast, you have 60 seconds or less. So timer, where are you gonna be sitting? Oh, okay, so you wanna sit at the edge of the stage? Okay, or you can sit in the first row. And give the hairy eyeball. All right, so you can also encourage the relay participants with a ready, set, go, if you like, or a huzzah, or any sort of exclamation you want. All right, so welcome everybody, I'll be number one, but I need a little encouragement. Okay. Where we lay our scene, from ancient grudge bred to new mutiny, where civil blood makes civil hands unclean. From forth the fatal loins of these two foes, a pair of surface lovers take their life, whose misadventure piteous overthrows. Doth with their death bury their parents' strife. The fearful passage of their death marked love and the continuance of their parents' rage, which but their children's end not could remove, is now the 2 hours' traffic of our stage, the which if you, with patient ears attend, what here shall miss, our toil shall strive to mend.
Oh, for a muse of fire that would ascend the brightest heaven of invention.
When in disgrace with fortune and men's eyes, I all alone beweep my outcast state,
would thou be the same in thine own act and valorous and with art and desire?
Thrice, noble Titus, spare my firstborn son!
And do you still cry where and how and wherefore?
Take my milk for gall, you murdering ministers, wherever in your sight the substance is, you wait on nature's mischief.
I am waked with it when I sleep, raised with it when I sit, driven outdoors with it when I go from home.
Set your heart at rest. The fairy land buys not the child of me.
Faster than springtime showers comes thought on thought, and not a thought but thinks on dignity.
Be not. Was't you that reveled in our parliament and made a preachment of your high descent?
Hark, angels, make it say.
So we'll live and pray and sing and tell old tales and laugh at gilded butterflies.
That's not true. Oh, that's not so. Oh, she is lame. Love's heralds should be thoughts.
Why, we have goals. And though we have some grace, yet have we some revenge.
Purger of the world, give us the bones of our dead kings.
Fires what?
Flaying, boiling in leads or oils.
What old or newer torture must I receive, whose every word deserves to taste of thy most worst?
I know no touch of consanguinity, no kin, no love, no blood, no soul so near me as the sweet Troilus.
A babble of green fields. Sir John Quotha.
For I will be horribly in love with her. I may perchance have some odd quirks and remnants of wit broken on me because I have railed so long against marriage, but does not the appetite alter?
Love is not love that alters when an alteration finds.
It is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing.
Dighton and Forrest, who I did suborn to do this piece of ruthless butchery.
Yet to wash your blood from off my hands, here in the view of men, I will unfold some causes of your deaths.
the crown and comfort of my life, your favor. I do give lost, for I do feel it gone, but know not how it went.
So it's funny how everyone looks normal, but inside they're Shakespearean, right? It's kind of funny. All right, thank you, participants. I hope audience members enjoyed that. I certainly did. Yeah? All right, so we'll continue with the panel.
Welcome, everyone. Thanks for being here. That was great, by the way. Melinda, thank you so much for sort of facilitating that and everyone who participated. My name is Joe Salvatore, and I teach in the Steinhardt School at NYU in the Educational Theater Program. And I'm a playwright and director, and one of the courses that I teach at NYU is the Shakespeare course. And I'm very happy to be here this evening, and thank Stacy and Kate for the invitation to come and be part of this evening. And so the panelists and I are looking forward to this conversation with you. The way the format will work is I'm going to ask the panelists to introduce themselves and say a little bit about their work. And I'm also going to ask them to think about the first Shakespeare speech or monologue that you needed to speak in public, let's say, and share that with us. And then the way we're going to work this is we will do a little bit of a discussion, and then we'll do one of the coaching sessions, and then a little bit of a discussion. So we'll move back and forth between these two sort of formats for the evening. So, Melinda.
Hi.
Hi.
Oh, okay, so what am I supposed to do? What do I do? I'm a Shakespeare coach and a director and a producer. A lot of you I know because you participate in something I produce called the annual Shakespeare's Birthday Sonnet Slam. Yay! Where basically I had a crazy idea to have 154 sonnets read aloud by 154 different people and share it with the world for free, and that's what I do with my partner, my husband. So that's what I'm doing, and I direct as much as I can. I love directing film. I love directing Shakespeare. I love coaching auditions. I love getting people jobs. I love getting jobs. let's see, the first time I had to speak Shakespeare in public, I think that I was a closet Shakespearean, honestly, but I'm coming out now. Thank you. If you didn't notice before, I don't know about doing a monologue when I was a teenager, but I certainly remember I had already gotten my undergraduate degree, and I decided I wanted to go study Shakespeare at a conservatory. And I had seen Earl Hyman play King Lear, and it was sort of pivotal for me. And I thought that I needed to learn more. I thought that, you know, my education was okay, but not great, and I wanted more. I just wanted more. So they had auditions for the National Shakespeare Conservatory, which was like a summer program, and then they had a program in the city. Mm-hmm. And the school's no more, but I remember driving to the audition, getting the appointment, being extremely nervous, even though it was only a summer program. I don't know. I think they would have just taken anybody, but and trying to learn Cordelia's, trying to do Cordelia's speech, but I didn't know enough to get an acting partner to play with. And so basically, I think I just mumbled in my room over and over and over in the car, you know, if I want the glib and oily art to a person. And I think it was just awful. But so I got there, and the guy, the auditor, sees me, and he says, "Oh, Melinda." And I said, "Hi." And he said, "Oh, I saw you in that show last week," because I was in a play, a contemporary play. He said, "I saw you in that show last week." And I said, "Okay, so should I do my, you know, Cordelia?" And he's like, "I am really hungry. You're in, you're fine. Just fill out this paperwork, and I'm gonna get some lunch."
That's a dream audition.
But my heart was sort of broken, because I really wanted, like, I think maybe the energy of the relay is the same. It's like, I wanted to do it whether I belly flopped or not. And anyway, so he spared me from that. But I ended up belly flopping, sure enough, in my first week of acting school. So it made up for it.
Excellent. Thank you, Tom.
It's never too late to belly flop. first Shakespeare, well, I'll get to that, I guess. My name's Tom Ridgely. I'm a director, primarily, and I've worked on Shakespeare plays at the Public and the Old Globe, and I was this year's Killian Fellow at the Oregon Shakespeare Festival. and I've also worked on Shakespeare with my company Waterwell, and I run the drama program at the Professional Performing Arts School here in the city. And the first Shakespeare monologue that I remember speaking aloud in public was To Be or Not to Be. And I wasn't even supposed to do it. I remember it was the junior year of my undergraduate acting class, and my teacher had given me my scene partner the nunnery scene, and so I was like, okay, great. And I was going through, and I was like, oh, there's this really great speech, that, you know, in the middle of this scene. So I was like, can I just do that too? You know, since it's basically like part of the scene. And I don't know why, but he said yes, which I feel, and looking back, I feel really bad for my scene partner. And I have no memory of how it went. I'm sure it was terrible, but I did it, and I got that out of the way. So now it was bucket list crossed off, to be or not to be. Now I never have to do it in front of anyone else ever again.
Thank you, Ian.
Hi, I'm Ian. What do? I work with Shakespeare a lot. I've worked at the Public, at the Old Globe, Shakespeare on the Sound. I do text coaching for productions. I direct productions. I teach a lot, and I teach conservatory students, MFA students. I teach prisoners. I teach high school students. I teach a lot of different people Shakespeare. And I've been doing it for a while. What else can I tell you? I enjoy it a lot. I love going into the prisons and working with the prisoners. There's a beautiful, you know, one day we went into my first time going into a prison to work was at Arthur Kill on Staten Island. And I did my little education workshop because then the Public was bringing in a mobile unit show of Measure for Measure. And as you did it, and I'm like, phew, it's done, you know? And this guy at the end, you know, raises his hand and says, I got something to say. And I was like, oh God, help me, you know? And his arms were like the size of my thighs. I started the workshop by saying, you know, I work at the Public Theater, which was started by a man named Joe Papp, who believed that there wasn't anything in life that wouldn't make people's lives a little better, a little brighter by throwing Shakespeare at it. And so Jose Antonio raised his hand and he said, hey, you know how you said that thing about that guy you work for who said, like, Shakespeare made things better and brighter? Well, you made our lives here today a little better, a little brighter. I was like, so I didn't get killed. So that's, you know, I love to do that work. I love all of the work that I do. I'm very blessed to be able to do it. My first monologue in public, you know, Shakespeare monologue, I don't remember, but the first time I remember it was in the eighth grade in Mrs. Clarkson's English class. And we had to memorize Romeo's But Soft, What Light Through Yonder Window Breaks. And here's what I remember about that, because I remember this because I was like, But Soft, What Light Through Yonder Window Breaks, But Soft, What Light Through Yonder Window Breaks, But Soft, okay, good. It is the East and Juliet is the Sun. It is the East and Juliet is the Sun. And my friend Sarah Beasley, now I was an actor, right? I was in all the school plays, and my friend Sarah Beasley comes up to me and goes, that's not how you memorize a monologue. And I was like, what do you know? She was like, you memorize the thoughts, Ian, not the lines. And I was like, of course, that's what I teach now.
Excellent. Okay. And I shared the same speech in ninth grade. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I was hoping that someone would share a brutalizing speech about public school memorizing Shakespeare in front of the English class, because did other people have that experience? Yeah, yeah. It's like brutalizing to sit through and to do, I think. But also can be transformative if you have a good experience doing it. I did not. I did.
It looks like you got
I
over get, it.
Yeah, I guess I did. Yeah, but yeah, curriculum. Okay, so transitioning. You know, how to nail your Shakespeare audition. Okay, we continually come back to this playwright in performance, and so it's important to be able to navigate the work. Why do we think that it's important, besides getting the gig, to have Shakespeare in our arsenal as performers. So not simply just getting cast in a Shakespeare play, getting the gig, but what else does sort of working through this playwright's work channel for us as actors, performers? So I'd like to sort of start there this evening.
Well, I mean, practically speaking, like every regional theater does at least one Shakespeare a year, it sort of, you know, opens your opportunity as an actor. And if you can do it well, you know, then that puts you ahead of the game.
Other thoughts?
I think it builds your chops. I mean, if you feel that vocally perhaps you're a little weak, or your breath support's not where it needs to be, or for comprehension, for even, I teach at the SAG Conservatory, we do cold reading Shakespeare, but basically it improves people's commercial cold reading skills. Because if you can
absolutely
cold read, yeah, you can cold read Shakespeare, you can go do a Tylenol commercial, you know. So I think it just assists an actor. It's there for an actor to build your craft.
Okay, great. Tom, do you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, obviously the technical demands are really extreme. So that if you can meet that bar, you know, it makes almost everything else a whole lot easier. And I think also, you know, just as actors and as artists, there's something about spending time with his work that just expands you and enlarges you and allows you to connect more with characters, no matter who they're written by. And it just sort of places you in the world in a way that few other writers really can. And I think that's important. I think that's part of our job. And so given that he's a dramatist and he's sort of in our field, you know, that resource is available to us. It's just this, it feels like this well that you can keep going to over and over and over again for refreshment, not just sort of technical professional refreshment, but also for sort of spiritual refreshment to sort of survive in this business. You know, there's few greater sources of power and comfort than Shakespeare's plays.
I also kind of think it changes your brain chemistry. I don't know, does anyone agree with that? But is it dopamine? I don't know what it is, but it works.
Can you think of a contemporary playwright that you've worked on whose work, like if you think about Shakespeare's work, how the skills that Shakespeare requires contributes to the skills that you need for the contemporary playwright's work? Does anybody come to mind when you think about that?
Tennessee Williams, Stephen Adley Gergis.
Mm-hmm.
Kushner.
Yep. Yeah. Susan Laurie Parks comes to mind when I think about it. Okay, so that's, I think that's part of, I feel like this has a dual purpose this evening, you know, that not only are we thinking about Shakespeare, but that, and sort of the performance of Shakespeare, but what does this playwright's work offer us just sort of in our actor toolbox, you know, so that we can take what we sort of observe and talk about from this evening into all the work that we do. Should we move into the first coaching?
I also think that, like, just as Melinda was saying, it's like everything benefits from doing Shakespeare, but there's also something very akin with David Mamet's work and Sam Shepard that really dovetails very nicely in terms of like fresh thought, coming up with ideas one at a time, the pause, the famous David Mamet pause.
Yeah. You know. Yeah, there's something about the specificity and level of detail in the language that I think translates to other contemporary playwrights. Who's our first coaching person? Great. The Duchess, yes. Okay. Duchess of Gloucester, Richard II, tell us your name.
Jacqueline Margolis.
Welcome. Thank you.
Find brotherhood in your sharpest burr. Hath love in thy old blood thy living fire. Edward's seven sons were of thyself all one, or seven bars of his most precious blood, or seven fair branches springing from one root. Some of those branches are dry by nature's course, some by the destiny's cut. But Thomas, my lord, my life, my Gloucester, one flourishing branch of his most royal root, is cracked and all his precious liquor spent, is hacked down as some leaves all faded. Oh, gaunt his blood and thine. That bed, that womb, that cell and mold, that fashion thee made him mad. No, thou livest to breathe as if thou art slain in him. Thou dost consent in some large measure to thy father's death, and hath seen thy brother to be slaughtered, who was the man of thy father's life. Oh, my patience, God, is despair. In suffering thus, thy father, to be, brother, to be slaughtered, thou showest the naked pathway to thy life, teaching sternly, murder too butcherly, but mean then we entitle patience as pale and cold cowardice and noble breasts. What shall I say? To safeguard thine own life, I must revenge my foster's death.
Thank you. Thanks very much.
Wonderful. So,
Melinda.
I don't know, do you need a chair so we can talk, or yeah?
Thank you.
Okay.
Sure. Gentlemen.
Yeah. Joe's such a gentleman.
I'll just plant myself over here. How about that?
Okay. I want to ask what you like about this monologue. Why do you pick it, and do you use it frequently for auditions?
No, it's actually very new to me. I think I've worked on it once. It's very new. I think I worked on it. Oh, it's like something I think I worked on it a couple of years ago. I don't even remember if I brought it into class. Maybe I brought it into class once, but it's not something I ever use for some reason. I don't know why. But I decided I might start trying it because of the age range.
Sure. Yeah, no, it's right for you. Do you want to play this part?
Yeah, I'd like to.
Okay,
like
so
to.
A tip that I have is know the part you want and go after it. If you see a casting for this part, I think you should go after it. That's my feedback.
I don't know.
Some people say avoid the role that you want, you know, in an audition if you see the posting, but I disagree with that. Gentlemen, do you have any thoughts on that?
I would agree with that, yeah, certainly. If the role is available and you see yourself in it, then go for it, for sure. How did you approach it? What were the first few things you did once you'd chosen it?
Actually, when I looked at it, I saw, and I read it, I was thinking about my brother-in-law, you know? Yeah. I mean, I worked with him in my mind, you know, and the children.
In terms of who you were speaking to?
Yeah, right. I mean, that was my base. That's what I thought. Like, we had children, and he was my brother-in-law, you know? So I started to use my life. I actually haven't been... I'd say I haven't really been working. I mean, when I started, that's how I did. Now it kind of flashes back on me. I think I need to work on it more again.
Well, we're never done working on these speeches.
You get up and do it and realize, you know, like there are things that you could go back and think about again.
Could you summarize the speech in sort of your own words, just briefly?
What are you talking about? I'm trying to save his son's life. You know, that's what's really going on. His son is going to do battle with, I forgot the guy's name, whatever. That Mia, the guy.
Put the mic up.
I'm trying to save his son, my nephew's life. I'm trying to get him to stop it before it goes to battle. They're going to meet somewhere, you know, on their horses, charge, sword, kill each other, whatever. Whoever comes out first, Medford and whatever. And I'm trying to get him to get past this, you know, God will come in, you know. I'm trying to get him to take his life in his own hands. He's responsible.
Yeah.
So when you say to safeguard thine own life, the best way is to avenge my Gloucester's death.
Right.
So what are you really seeking here? What do you want him to do? I mean, you want something very, very specific from him. You want him to take your revenge because they killed your son. So
right.
I get.
No, they killed my husband.
Or your husband. All
they
right.
They killed my husband.
Yeah. So.
But that's a way. I mean, I want revenge. But what I'm really, I mean, yes, you can think in terms of revenge, but.
Well, that's.
But that's the words. That's the metaphor. What I'm using. What I'm. Really, I mean, revenge is one thing, but you're also dealing with blood.
Yeah, like but you're talking. You're talking so long because you want something.
Right.
And you have the reason why we listen to you is because you're trying to get something from him.
Right.
Right. Over and over, and you got it, and you try different ways to get in there.
Right.
This time, I felt it was very much. I got your sort of, you know, despair. In it, but I wonder if there's any other colors that you might find in that as you try and manipulate your brother-in-law to get him to do it. And even this thing like, to safeguard thine own life, the best way is to avenge my Gloucester's death. That kind of feels to me like a little bit of a manipulation even. Mm-hmm. Like you're, you know, this is, you know, it's for you too. But right. Really, I don't think you're the nicest lady on earth.
I'm trying to make it stronger.
Yeah. I think.
Actually, yeah, I agree. And what you want to do, or what everyone wants to do, is when you lay out a monologue, you have to have a beginning, a middle, and an end. And they have to be very different. And the character we meet at the top of your monologue has to be a different finish. So here, I thought you did a nice job, but there wasn't a lot of change. And so I would say for you, challenge yourself. Do you come in sweet, and then do you end with a fire? Do you burn down the house? Do you rip his heart out? Like, what happens? Because it doesn't matter in the whole context of the play. We're not going to see the play. Right. We got to see you get at least a callback. That's our goal, right?
Right.
So you got to bring it on, you know. I say this to my regular students. It's got to be little surprises that keep opening and opening and opening that we don't see coming. So if you repeat yourself, and you know what I'm saying, by repeating yourself, by repeating those actions or your gesture or your stance or your focus, if you keep repeating yourself, the audience gets used to it.
No, I felt like I had a pattern there. But
sure.
But
so,
that stuff you just gave me was, I can see where I
yeah,
can
Yeah, so let's challenge you.
It.
Yeah, let's challenge you. Do you want it to play a little bit?
Sure.
Okay, so I would challenge you, firstly, to have a point of focus, know exactly where he is and where you're saying this to him. And then is it some of it direct address? Are you using any of the audience to get on your side or not? That's your decision.
Right.
I'm just throwing it out there. That would be my two notes. Anybody else have a note for her? Can we see it one more time?
Sure.
With a note? Anybody else?
Well, I just want to see you try one thing at a time, because the reason why you're talking is because you think what you're doing is going to work. And you can't go on to the next thing until you realize the first thing hasn't worked. And that's what spurs you on to the next tactic.
Yeah, thank you. And thanks for playing, too. So get back on to Mark, and let's try it again.
Finds brotherhood need no sharper spur. There we go. Finds brotherhood need no sharper spur. Had love in thy old blood, no living fire. Edward's seven sons were of thyself a one. Or seven vials with most precious blood. Or seven fair branches springing from one root. Some of those branches are dried by nature's course. Some by the destiny's cut. But Thomas, my lord, my life, my Gloucester. One vial of his most precious blood, one flourishing branch of his most raw root is cracked, and all his precious liquor spilt, is hacked down, and his summer leaves all faded. Our God's blood was thine. That bed, that womb, that metal, that self-mold, that fashion thee, made him a man. Though thou livest and breathest, yet thou art slaying him. Thou dost consent in some large measure to thy father's death, in that seeing thy brother to be slaughtered, who was the model of thy father's life. Call it not patience, call it fear's despair. In suffering thus thy brother to be slaughtered, thou showest a naked pathway to thy life, teaching stern murder to butcher thee. What mean then we entitled patience? Is pale, cold cowardice in noble breasts? What shall I say? To safeguard thine own life, thou must revenge my Gloucester's death.
That was a great adjustment. Yeah. Thank you.
Yes.
I like that pass. I had more variation for me. I don't know. Anybody else?
Yeah, more variation. I understood it this time. There was a lot in the middle that I was very muddy for me the last time.
I agree, this time through,
I got the difference.
I've had nobody work. I've done it myself.
Well, that was good work that you did.
Yeah, very good. You know, I just said I'd try it. You know, right?
Yeah, and you really brought it home at the end in a really great way, which Shakespeare always sort of seems to want us to do in his speeches, right? He always sort of writes in some kind of build, and it's usually at the very end, you know, to sort of land on the climax or the point or what he's trying to get the other person to, you know, to think or feel. As a preparation thing, Shakespeare always, his characters are very organized thinkers. Mm-hmm. So as you get a piece, like, one of the first things to do is to sort of try to identify what their, like, the organization is of their thoughts and sort of break it down, you know, into, you know, into beats or sections or whatever. But there's little clues in the text where you can tell that they're trying a new tactic or you know, a new approach, or where the argument is just sort of turning one way or the other. And there's a couple great ones in this too, you know. You know, it starts off with this list of the seven sons and how they're all sort of branched from one root, and then, you know, but Thomas, my dear Lord, like that but just sort of like spins it around and it sort of cries out for some, you know, for a new tactic there. Those are just sort of little signposts.
Uh-huh. Yeah. I always when I'm working on a history play, when I'm teaching it, I feel like the Duchess always speaks the truth. Like the Dutch eye, I like to say, always tell it like it is. And I feel like this is an example of her trying to get him to do something, but she's also telling it like it is. And in that second pass, I started to get that command of knowledge that I think in the history plays the Dutch eye often have. And I think it's important as a character choice to accept that, you know, that these women in these history plays often speak the truth, or say things that the men are unwilling to say in a very direct way. And I got that in the second pass, so well done.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks very much. Just so you know, I'm not up here checking my email. I'm just trying to time our coaching session so that we stay on point. So I promise I'm not ordering my dinner through Seamless.
Sure.
Up here, okay? I'm here all week. Okay, this monologue gives us a great sort of entree into the next discussion. And Melinda, you sort of brought it up. You know, how do we make choices for monologues to take into auditions? What is the, you know, how do we go about making these choices? You know, what suggestions do you have in terms of making those choices, whether it be age appropriate, gender appropriate, race ethnicity appropriate, which is hard to do with Shakespeare? What are some suggestions that we have?
Well, it's interesting. On one hand, I think that it should be a playground. You should be able to play any role you want to play and go out there and use that audition to do that. But on the other hand, there's the realistic part of it. Will I ever play Hamlet? I don't know. I mean, is it worth me doing that audition? How castable? I'd have to find a really open-minded director to look at me and see Hamlet. Not saying that I don't have Hamlet ready to go, but that, you know, realistically, is that what's going to sell tickets? I'm not sure. So I think identifying the part you want is the priority. What do you want? When you see the play, when you go see the play, and you see the actors do it, which one are you jealous of, really? Like, which one do you go, I want to do that, you know? And go from there. And definitely get in with a coach or a class and bring in material. You know, don't be alone in your choices. Bring in material, because people might throw stuff at you that might surprise you. Might think, oh, I'm not right for that. And then they throw something comedic or dramatic at you, and you go, oh, I actually do love that. So I guess I'm saying to the actor, be open-minded, but if you, in your gut, you know you want something, go get it.
Yeah, there's no hard and fast rules, and I think certainly a really amazing surprise can really impress someone in an audition room. But by and large, the best strategy would be to choose something that's at least age and gender appropriate. Beyond that, I think there are no rules, and especially, you'll know a lot about the project going in, whether it's an all-female Hamlet or comedy of errors set in the Harlem Renaissance. You know, that'll sort of clue you in terms of, you know, what characters you're probably best for. But to really throw a curveball at someone, like, A, you would have to know going in that they dig that kind of thing, and B, you would have to know that you could totally destroy that piece, yeah, and really amaze them. Otherwise, you'll seem crazy.
Well, and they might be like, great audition, but no, we're not hiring that person.
I think you touched on a really good point there. I used to be the casting director for the Shakespeare Lab at the Public, and I would sit through 50 auditions a day. Those were general auditions, basically. You know, like, I wanted to see that you knew how to speak and that you knew how to carry an intention through Shakespeare's words, that you could make an argument. So in that sense, it didn't really matter to me what the piece was, so long as you could embody it, make sense of it, you know, and bring a little personality to it, you know, of your own personality. So in that sense, in a general audition, I think it's less, you know, whatever. However, I will say, you know, that if you're going to, I'll agree with Tom, that like if you're going to bring in something that's outrageous, like I had a guy bring in Juliet to me, and he was like, I want to do Juliet. And I was like, okay, he's a crazy person. And then he was like, you know, and he explained to me why, and I was like, okay, you know, go ahead, do it. And, you know, he did a really good job with it, you know, but I would have preferred that he had, like, blown it out of the water. And when I say that, I don't mean, like, blown it out of the water, like, done, you know, like, Sturm und Drang, everything all over the place, loud. I just mean, like, he'd really been inside it and, you know, each moment by moment, thought by thought, passed through the monologue to the end and come to some beautiful conclusion. And I think he did a good job. You know, and I didn't penalize him for it, but you gotta choose wisely. But most important, do what you think you do best. Because you're going into, especially in a general audition, you're going into a room to say, hey, this is what I can do, and this is what I do best. So pick the thing that excites you, pick the thing that moves you, pick the thing that all your friends say, oh my God, do that one, you know? Because that's the one that you wanna bring in.
Yeah, it's kind of, I always say that choosing monologues in general, but I think specifically with Shakespeare, it's like trying on prom dresses.
Yeah.
You know, like you try on a lot, well, I guess, you, or
tell
you
us,
try.
Tell us more, Joe.
Yeah. Sorry. You try on a lot of clothes until you find the one that fits, right? And I tend to coach a lot of women, and so we use the prom dress analogy. Dug myself out of that one. Okay. So, sure. But I,
hey, you know what? This is Shakespeare, honey.
Well,
you can
right.
do whatever
Mark
you want.
Mark Rylance can do it, you know. So, but I do think that I've had students come to me and they think that on the first pass they're going to find the right monologue, and I think that that's unrealistic. I think that it takes 2, 3, 4 attempts to find one that really works.
And by saying, but actually, I would also encourage people not to abandon their monologue.
Right.
Don't just bring it to a coach or a class once and say, oh, you know, it didn't really stick. No, I think you should really work on it. You know, give it a good month of shopping it around and trying it at auditions and trying it in different classes and really make sure you're getting everything you want to get out of it.
And then the other piece that you said that I think is important is like knowing who you're auditioning for. Like if you're auditioning for the Worcester Group's version of a Shakespeare play, there may be some more flexibility, right, in the interpretation. If you're doing something for the National Shakespeare Theater, it's probably pretty straightforward. And so knowing what the company is and knowing who the director is, I think really is kind of a smart piece to sort of make a decision about how adventurous one can be in the monologue presentation. The fourth, Robin Rose Singer. Okay, so you will be our fourth. So you can come join our, you can come down to contestants row over here. You're the next contestant.
You are the next contestant on Shakespeare's Ride.
We'll spin the wheel later at the end too. Okay, so which one of you would like to go next?
Right.
Okay, great. Come on up. Okay, I think the X marks the spot. And you are?
Martha Gaio.
Martha, welcome. And you are doing?
Lady M.
A gonorrheal speech.
Oh, gonorrheal. Hmm?
Lovely. Okay, great. We're ready whenever you are. Yes, the mics are going to pick you up. We're going to watch you right from here.
Lady, and lady wrongs me every hour. He flashes into one gross crime or other that sets us all at odds. I'll not endure it. His nights were riotous, and himself upbraids us on every trifle. When he returns from hunting, I will not speak with him. Say, I am sick. If you come slack the former services, you shall do well. quarters. I'll answer. Put on what weary negligence you please, you and your fellows. I'll have it come to question. If you dislike it, let him to our sister, whose mind and mine I know in that are one, not to be overruled. I, old man, but still would manage those authorities that he hath given away. Now, by my life, old fools are babes again and must be used with checks as flatteries. And though these knights have colder looks among you, what grows of it, no matter. Advise your fellow so. I would breed from hence occasions, and I shall, that I may speak. I'll write straight to my sister to hold my very course. Go, prepare for dinner.
Okay, great. So,
would you like to join us?
Yes.
Okay, sure. I was like kind of torn between here and there, and
that's okay.
We were with you.
Yeah, great. Okay.
That was really clear, like extremely well spoken. I thought. Oh. Is it a piece that you've been with for a while?
I studied this.
Use your microphone.
In November, I was studying. And a teacher gave it to me, but I saw Langella, and then I saw the other one at Tifana. It was like the year of Lear. There was Frank Langella out at BAM, and then another Lear at Tifana, and I knew they were doing Lear this summer. So I was like, hey, let me go with this one, because I didn't know it first when I took the class, but that was it, year of Lear, I guess.
Did you find those performances influenced your interpretation in any way?
I found it very interesting because knowing the monologue and seeing, you know, such accomplished actors, one of the speeches in Goneril, and I won't say which one, switched the old fools are babes again and said old babes are fools again in the performance. And it was interesting because I'm sitting there going, oh, okay, so it's okay to, you know, it was interesting.
Is that a choice? Are you allowed to choose between those two readings?
I don't think it was a choice. Oh. I think she just, she's just dyslexic.
Oh, she just mixed it up.
Yeah, the quarto and the folio are very different.
I knew there were two different versions. So how did you approach this? You said you found it in a class?
Yes, a teacher assigned it to me. And, I mean, there were several different monologues that we worked on in that. But, I thought it was quite interesting, and I approached it. I come from a music background, and I've been interested in Shakespeare all my life, just loving Shakespeare, but I haven't been acting so many years, and I approached it very much like I would. I was classically trained in music, so I approached it very similarly to that. I find that has worked very well.
I think you did a really lovely job, a really excellent job, but I want to ask, what do you think it would take for you to go to the next level with it? What do you think it would take for you to just bring it home and make sure you walk out of there with the role?
Being more relaxed, for one thing. Yeah. And
well, I feel you sort of relaxed into it partway through it.
Yes,
like I felt the beginning was really kind of pushed. Very understandable. I agree with everything that you said. Like, I got it. I knew what was going on. I knew what you were talking about. But I felt like you felt like there was some emotional high watermark that you had to reach at the beginning, rather than just you're talking to Oswald, right? Or whatever
his
name is.
Yes, to Oswald.
Yeah, to Oswald. And who is Oswald to you?
Well, he is. He's in charge of all of the servants in the house.
Right, but who is he to you?
And I know that. And I know I am sexually attracted to him. I understand that, and at least that
I didn't know that. That's cool.
Okay.
Always a solid choice.
That was my idea.
But I think he is someone
unhappy.
That you go to. I think he's like a confidant.
Oh, absolutely.
I think he's like your, the guy you dish with, you know. And
definitely,
he's a solution guy.
I was venting.
Yeah,
and as you said, having him in my confidence.
I kind of like that suggestion, and maybe if you want to rehearse one more time, what if she loves dishing? What if dishing? And but then it's like when you have a story, and then it's worse and worse and worse. Like the indignation goes like from normal dishing to kind of ripping the guts out in a way. Yeah. I don't know, but like the dishing thing, I think is a really good clue. For building the piece.
And I would just add to that, don't have a plan when you start to speak. You're just, oh my God, this guy is driving me up the wall, and not know what your plan is, and then come up with it piece by piece by piece. So we get to see you piece together this plan. Very interesting for us in the audience to watch you think your way to a solution rather than have decided off stage and bring it on. I figured this out off stage, but I'm just gonna tell you what it is. And I have a mantra that I like to use with my students, which is realize, don't report. So that you always are like realizing in the moment rather than reporting something that you already learned.
Yeah, we wanna see you get the idea.
Yeah.
And there's something technical in here that this is 18 lines of text.
Yes, but I'm sorry, I didn't write the last part because I thought it was only a minute, and then I found out it was a minute
That's
and a half.
That's cool.
So I didn't write.
But in the 18 lines that you have here, there are 13 sentences, 13 end marks, periods. And so it's totally linked to what Ian is just saying about those short sentences within the 18 lines, I think are a real clue about what she's trying, like how, sometimes we think in these bursts of like, oh, there, you know, oh, that's another idea, or maybe I should do, or maybe it's this, or, but, you know, and you talked about being a musician and musical training, rather than it being legato, right, long and extended, it's
more staccato,
and I think it technically links to what Ian is saying about the discovery of the speech as you do it.
And if you want to play that you're kind of hot for Oswald, I think in your opening moment, when you focus on him, when you lock eyes with him, it's got to be exciting for you. You got to really see that guy, that he turns you on. So can you try that as your establishing moment?
I'll try that.
And then dish, dish, dish.
Okay. And get frustrated, I guess, huh?
Great.
I don't know. Maybe this is how they get together. I don't know. Tom, did you have anything else?
No, realize, don't report.
Find that sexy man.
Max, stand up.
My day and night he wrongs me every hour. He flashes into one gross crime or other that sets us all at odds.
No, I'm sorry to stop you. Can you really find him and lock eyes with him and have an opinion about him before you start speaking and then go?
And night he wrongs me. Every hour, he flashes into one gross crime or other that sets us all at odds. I'll not endure it. His nights grow riotous and himself upbraids us on every trifle. When he returns from hunting, I will not speak with him. Say, I am sick. If you come slack of former services, you shall do well. The fault of it. I'll answer. Put on what weary negligence you please, you and your fellows. I'll have it come to question. If he'd slack it, let him to our sister, whose mind and mine I know and that are one, not to be overruled. Idle old man, that still would manage those authorities that he hath given away. Now, by my life, old fools are babes again, and must be used with checks these flatteries. When they are seen abused, remember what I tell you. And let his knights have colder looks among you. What grows of it, no matter. Advise your fellows so. I would breathe from hence occasions, and I shall, that I may speak. I'll write straight to my sister to hold my very course. Go. Prepare for dinner.
Yeah, definitely some fun discoveries there, some more variety in there, which is always great. One great trick to do with these monologues is to sort of create them, create little scenes out of them. And this is a great example. If there are that many sort of individual sentences and thoughts within the speech, you can sort of break it out and write it out as a dialogue. And Oswald, give Oswald sort of questions to ask you or responses that force you to elaborate further or to emphasize something that, or to keep working to change his mind.
He keeps saying, yes, mistress. Yes,
yeah.
Mistress.
Yeah. Or he keeps saying, so what? Or he keeps saying, who cares? Or he keeps saying, so? And you have to, the next thing is to sort of, you have to try another way to convince him.
I'll actually do that with students that I'm working with, where they'll be working on a monologue, and I'll just be like, what? What else? Tell me something else. You want me to do what? You know, so it sort of, it spurs the thought. So you have that moment of inspiration of, oh, now I have something else to try. You know,
I think it's funny, like this is an opportunity to say, don't forget your scene partner. You know, even though it's a monologue, it's really not a monologue. It is a scene with another character that you have to play, that they're really real for you, for your character.
And you have to play that you're not intending to deliver a monologue, that you're intending to just sort of get something from someone, and you try something, and it doesn't, you, every sort of thought, like, you know.
You have to believe that the thing you say is going to work to get the job done, or else you wouldn't say it. You have to have confidence that this thing that you're going to do is going to get him to do what you want him to do. And then when he doesn't, then you have to find something else. I mean, maybe that doesn't work perfectly for this one, but, you know, like, he's still in the room rather than going out and telling him what you told him, you know, doing what you told him.
Thank you. Thanks.
Great
Thank
job.
Thank you. Thanks. Okay, let me see here. We're sort of sharing some of these things as we're working on these, as we're looking at these coaching. Ian, you just said, what was that? You have that catchphrase.
Realize, don't report.
Realize, don't report. Okay, I totally want to use that if that's okay.
Sure.
If I can borrow that.
Just footnote it.
I will credit it. I will credit it.
That and the Dutch eyes speak the truth.
Okay, have at it. Tom, Melinda, do you have little sort of like I call them T-shirt or bumper sticker phrases that you use when you're coaching, things that you ask people to really think about when they're working, that I find they're useful for me as an actor or a performer or a director when I'm working to have those little things. Do you have ones that you use that are related to?
Well, in other words, I'm sure I repeat myself all the time, as my students could probably say, but really surprise us.
Mm.
You know, do something different with the material. You know, don't, if you feel like you're stuck in a line reading, it's probably because it's true. So find an action that doesn't match the previous action and play it. You know, become kind of master of your monologue. Don't back down from it.
And when in that kind of advice, how do you sort of navigate the context of the play that the monologue sits in with that kind of advice? Because I think that's really important sort of improvisationally to discover, but I just wonder how do you then take that to the next step when you're going into an audition and there's an expectation that the monologue is happening within the context of the play?
Well, if you play within the context of the play, the character only has certain information up to that point where the monologue is performed, right?
Right.
So you can't play the end of the play, which sometimes happens. You see someone playing, you know, they say, oh, and then after this scene, this happens. Mm. Well, wait a minute. How would the character know that? I think that you have to show a lot of range. So I don't know about strictly adhering to this is exactly what you're limited to via actions. In that sense, I'm not sure. I don't know.
For me, it's verbs and antitheses. If I had to boil it down to two things, because there's 1,000 Shakespearean, you know, scansion techniques that you can employ that can be really useful, and there's a lot of Shakespearean acting that's just good acting. But you know, obviously, you're often pressed for time. You don't have all day, even if you do have a long time, I feel like your time is gonna be best rewarded by focusing on those two things, because antitheses, more often than not, will sort of carry the thought and the argument that Shakespeare's having his characters make. Mm-hmm. He's setting things in opposition in order to sort of articulate a point of view or to persuade someone to do something. And verbs, in addition to carrying a whole lot of meaning in themselves, sort of convey the emotion of what they're feeling more than anything else. So, I mean, if you had time to do two things with a Shakespeare speech, I would underline all the verbs in it, and I would highlight all the, you know, the antithetical sort of ideas, the things that are set off in opposition to each other. And if you can let the force of those things, if you can energize those words, then you will connect to the piece more emotionally. And I think the people listening to it will have so much of an easier time just even understanding what the heck you're saying. And that, more than all the emotional investment in the world, is going to make them grateful and impressed by your piece. So verbs and antitheses. There's other things, but that feels like the bedrock.
I just remembered my catchphrase. If you believe, I believe, mm-hmm. which isn't my invention, but I think it works, because if you believe you're really talking to Oswald, I will believe you. If you believe you're in that audition room and like you're not really prepared and it's a little confusing, and then I'm not going to believe that you really need him or that he exists. So if you believe, I believe.
I just want building in on what was being said about verbs and antitheses. I'll just a little story, right? Because this happens from time to time. I went into a Hamlet audition and I read for Claudius. And they're like, that was a great read. That was a great read. We're thinking about doubling it with the ghost. Could you read the ghost? Well, the ghost is like 2 pages long, you know? And they said, go ahead, take 3 minutes outside. You know, I spent 3 days preparing Claudius, and then like, you know, and the ghost is like the part. Man, that's the part in that show. And so that's exactly what I did. I'm like, verb, 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 antithesis. And then if I have time, then I go back and I'm like, okay, thought, 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 new thought, new thought, so that it moves along like that. And just to, you know, this realize, don't report, I have an exercise that I love to do that I'm just going to offer up to everybody, which is I like to go through the monologue and I like to say the phrase, oh my God, I just thought of this, out loud, as I do the monologue. Like, oh my God, I just thought of this. What's Montague? You know? So it actually, then you have to say the line that follows it as if you just thought of it. It doesn't work if you don't do that. But it sort of, it gives it a spring and a buoyancy and just a way of working through the monologue thought by thought, which with each thought being new. And that tends to draw us in a little more. So,
as I was watching the relay, I was thinking, I had a teacher who said that the only thing that we have left of Shakespeare is his plays, or the plays, let's say, and that the way that if actors speak the text with integrity, that they channel him and bring him back into the room. And so it becomes sort of this... it's a little bit, you know, spiritual, woo-hoo-hoo, you know. But I felt that when the relay was happening a little bit. But I also thought about seeing before saying, because Shakespeare's language is so visual, and we're not like flying helicopters in and doing turntables and like lots of scene changes, at least when he wrote the plays. So... the language does that work for us, right? And so if the actor doesn't see the imagery before speaking it, then the audience isn't going to see it. And so developing the specificity around the images in the language, if it's full of images, is important. So sometimes I will add, you know, what does the light look like coming through the window behind Juliet? You know, what does that look like? What's the quality of that light? And I don't know. Okay, we'll make a decision about that, because if you make a decision, then I will know that it's pale yellow and warm. Okay? If the decision isn't made, it just becomes two-dimensional. And I think that this is a playwright that offers us a lot of imagery to work with in terms of language. So.
Yeah, and know that the only reason the character is using that imagery is because they've just in that moment realized that right. is the image that is being captured.
Mm. Yeah, it's immediate.
What it's great, though, is that how you see it reveals who you are. So that's why everyone can do a different interpretation exactly. of the same character, and it's still exciting.
Exactly. Next person. Excellent. Sir.
Thank you.
Do you have a copy for us by chance?
I don't have a copy.
Okay. All right. Tell us your name.
Carsey Walker Jr.
Carsey Walker Jr., welcome.
Thank you.
And what's the piece you're going to do for us?
The Mrs. Cinnabarbus, Antony Cleopatra.
Great. Okay. We're ready whenever you are.
Bear me witness, knight. Be witness to me, O thou blessed moon. When men revolted shall upon record bear hateful witness. Boy, no barbers did before thy face repent. O sovereign mistress of melancholy, the poisonous damp of night to sponge on me, that life, a very rebel to my will, may hang no longer on me. Throw my heart against the flint and hardness of my fault, which being dry with grief will break to powder and end all foul thoughts. O Antony, nobler than my revolt is infamous. Forgive me in thine own particular, but let the world rank me in register, a master lever and a fugitive. O Antony, O Antony.
Okay. Panelists.
Nice job. Good. But you know what happened for me was, you know, with Shakespeare, we always have to find the balance between the emotional connection and the words. And I felt like your emotional connection overpowered the words at one point, and I couldn't understand what you were saying. And if that happens, then I wonder why we have the words. So I wonder.
Me too. Why not just let me come in and yell?
Yeah. Well, that's sort of what happened. And I wonder if there's a way that we can do it so that the words sort of carry what you're feeling, what you're going through, rather than kind of overpowering it and pushing it down.
It's the difference between being on the line and off the line in some ways. And so how can we stay on the line rather than acting off the line in between the line? And so what I just want to say, I really appreciated your focus, really strong focus even from over here. I felt like your engine was running through the whole thing. It didn't dip for me. And I felt like there was a clear understanding of the stakes, but I did lose some of the words, and so the emotion of it was very clear. The strength of the emotions. I just kind of wanted to know the why of the emotion, if that makes sense with the words.
I think that articulation is an easy fix, though. Mm-hmm. I don't think that's going to. I think you have one more rehearsal, and you nailed that. I don't think that's going to hold you back. But you did bring up an interesting point for me. I know today, like, you're working with a camera and you're on a mark and that kind of thing. But what about the physicalization of this? Sometimes when I'm working with my clients, I work on showing three levels, because a lot of the amphitheaters that do Shakespeare, they're big stages. So if you just stand still, dead center the whole time, is that enough? What about having three levels? What about being on the earth level? What about being eye level? And what about the level to God or to the heavens? So is there an opportunity in your piece to experience a different physical level? You know, perhaps we're not on a marker with cameras, perhaps it is a stage audition, that you could play with that. I don't mean like be loose and take up, you know, pacing or anything like that, but just enjoy it, because you have a command of your body, which is wonderful. But I think that you could kind of give us a little bit more of levels of just kind of the power that you have. Because to me, I feel like you're very powerful, but it's a little contained. So what would happen if you allowed yourself to expand your arms or to, I don't know, do you kneel? Do you beg? Do you, I don't know what happens. But anyhow, that was just my thought.
Yeah, it's always a choice, I think, in terms of how to, you know, bring the body into it. You know, obviously I thought the emotional connection was really powerful, and I was moved just by that alone, and I appreciated, honestly, how grounded and simple you kept things. Maybe there's a moment where a gesture could have carried a lot of meaning because you had been so still. And I thought the piece was really well just sort of crafted. You had a wonderful little turn at the end there that was a surprise and that was satisfying. I did lose the sense of it just because I'm not as familiar with the speech, but I honestly don't think it's a diction thing. I think you actually spoke pretty clearly. I think it's, I literally think it's a matter of carrying the sense of it across. And if I were you, I would go through and I would underscore those verbs. Because if you can lean into those, then I know what you're saying, and I know you're connected to it emotionally. I just felt a little sort of disconnected from it because I had trouble following the thoughts, just because it's complicated language, and I wasn't as familiar with the speech. But if you tell me the verb is the most, it's a play, it's an action, it's the most active thing. So that's what's telling us what you're doing and what you're saying and what you're trying to accomplish. So I would just go through and try, literally for exercise, just lift every one of them, you know what I mean? Like way out of, artificially almost, just to sort of feel how they carry the speech along. And then I think it'll be crystal clear and I think it'll be really powerful.
What is the word that he says the most? Because I don't have the text on me, but what is the word that he repeats the most?
Oh.
Of?
Probably.
Oh.
Is it Antony or is it O?
It's probably bear. I will put it this way. It's no more so O than bear. But anyway, it's prayer thing.
I'm just curious what he says more than any other word.
I'd have to go.
But that would be something that you could circle and then figure out, are you going to say it differently every time, or how do you endow it with a certain quality because of that word repetition. Word repetition in a monologue is a clue. It's a clue to show us more actions, really.
Absolutely, but I think you also need to know the argument that you're making, right? And that has to be very clear. You know, what do you want? You're talking to the moon. You're talking to Antony, you know, and they're not there. But what is it? There's some argument. There's some perspective, something that you want, that you need, that you're trying to figure out or decide what to do, right? And you're talking to these two people who aren't there to do that. And I thought you did that very well. I thought a lot of people are very shy about talking to, the inanimate objects that aren't there, in Shakespeare.
The imaginary friend.
But I thought you did that very, very nicely. It was beautiful, but there's an argument. There's something that you want. You have a position and you're trying to figure something out. Otherwise you wouldn't be talking.
Can you try it again, just for the hell of it?
Oh, just because you asked so nicely.
Please. I just like watching actors rehearse, basically.
There.
Bear me witness, knight. Be witness to me, O thou blessed moon. When men revolted shall upon record bear hateful memory, poor Inobarbus did before thy face repent. O sovereign mistress of melancholy, the poisonous death of night, to sponge on me that life, a very rebel to my will, may hang no longer on me. Throw my heart against the flint and hardness of my fault, which, being dried with grief, will break to powder and end all foul thoughts. Oh, Antony, nobler than my revolt is infamous, forgive me in thine own particular. Let the world rank me and register a master lever and a fugitive. Oh, Antony. Oh, Antony. Thank you.
thank you so much. That was so much
thank
fun.
Thank you. Yeah.
I
great.
Mean, for us to watch it.
You know, I think that the best thing for an actor to do is to take, like, is to make a choice. Because then there's, in terms of developing a character, developing a performance, the person that the actor is working with then has something to respond to. And I feel like you just gave us, like, a really strong example of making a choice and sort of following it and carrying it through and letting us see what's there. And I really appreciate that. So thank you for that, Carson.
And also, you're so quick with assimilating a note. I mean, that's wonderful. Thank you.
Well done. Thank you.
I'm gonna say a good adjustment, but I think you're a much better actor than you give yourself credit for. And I think that you were still pushing, and I don't think you need to. I think you have the emotional connection. I just think you have to trust that it's there and not worry about it so much, because you need to trust that you have the skills that you obviously have, and let it be, and not trying to gild the lily, so to speak.
Yeah, I lost a little bit more of the words that time in the emotion, but I think you're obviously a really brave and powerful actor, and so I think the homework is just clarity, both in terms of the thought and in the speech. But
can I ask how many?
You got
times
a lot of things.
You,
that's easy. That's a lot easier to practice than some of the other things
so
that you're just.
So you changed your position about the enunciation.
I thought actually that time was less clear diction-wise, just because the emotion was so full. I lost more words from the emotion that time.
How long have you worked on the piece?
I did this play a couple years ago, so.
Oh, you played the character.
I actually could not do this in rehearsals for a while. Like, I would try to just.
Well,
it,
I hope
taken
you,
out of context, but it's only.
I hope you get to play it again.
Thank you.
Congrats.
Thanks, Carson. Thank you. Okay, so we have about 20 minutes left, okay? So we wanna do just a quick discussion, another coaching, and then a final wrap up is where we are. So, how do you feel about, so we just talked about sort of having done this role, what's your experience sort of doing a role and then coming back to a role, or working with actors who do a role then come back to a role? After a period of time, does that affect the way you coach the actor? Do you ask the actor to reproduce what they did before? How does that sort of affect the way that you might approach coaching an actor or directing an actor in a given production if they've played the role before?
I mean, you're saying the words for the first time every time anyway, and I think you have to be available to what's going on inside rather than pre-decide what you're going to feel at what point. So if you're available to what's going on, then that's going to be different all the time. I don't really have an opinion. The only thing that I have about that is in an audition situation, if you bring in a monologue that you've worked on year after year after year and it won't change, you know, you can't change it, I would say that's not a great audition monologue, because for me, when I audition people, taking the adjustment is the most important thing ever, because I need to see that you can take a direction. I need to see that you can, you know, take something and move with it. So that would be the only thing about that question for me in terms of.
That's kind of what I was, yeah. That's what I was fishing for. Yeah.
Oh, okay,
so,
good.
Yeah. Well done, Ian.
Great.
Well, and also, I mean, I think that it's, these plays become iconic, right, in certain ways, like.
Absolutely.
How does one do Ophelia? How does one do the to be or not to be speech? And so I think that there, and I think audiences come to expect certain things when they come to see some of these plays.
Everybody has an opinion on how Hamlet should be done, how Ophelia should be done, how Romeo should be done, how Juliet should be done. I mean, it's really funny. I remember reading the review of the Hamlet done in the park back in 2008. And to me, Michael Stuhlbarg was the greatest Hamlet I've ever seen. He was so amazing, right? And Brantley didn't like him, you know? Hamlet is supposed to be dot, dot, dot.
Right.
So what I take from that is you have to do what you do, and you have to do what you do well, and you have to bring what you do best, and you have to do your best work regardless of whatever what anybody else is thinking, because there's always going to be someone who says, oh, no, that's wrong, or oh, I didn't like that. You know, I remember when I was in the Shakespeare lab 100 years ago, there was a guy who I just thought was the most amazing guy in the whole lab. He was so good. And then there was this casting director there who told me the story afterwards, who leaned into this guy and said, ugh, so presentational, don't you think? And the guy that he leaned into leaned back to him and said, that's my client.
But you know, it's
you can't please everybody, and if you try to please everybody, what happens is you get a really flat, general performance that has no personality, no sparkle, no pah.
Right, and so one of the questions that we were sort of that I had sent about was about like how do we sort of read casting directors and directors in terms of doing this work, and I think that it's very hard to try to be something other than who one is, right?
Exactly.
And so it so much of what we're sort of talking about is finding a piece that works, finding a piece that's representative of your skill set, and that people that is legible to casting directors and directors when we walk into the room, right?
And also, casting directors, it's all subjective, you know? Everyone has their aesthetic. You know, everybody has their thing that they like, you know, and I have my thing that I like. Someone else has their thing that they like when you come into a room and see what you see. These guys have, you know, their own thing. So you can't second guess and try and give them what they want, except for just doing your best and making sense, you know.
I came up with a theory that basically why we keep being interested in Shakespeare is because we're interested in ourselves. And Shakespeare is the perfect mirror of the human condition, and we are endlessly fascinated with looking at ourselves. And I think that Shakespeare offers us opportunity to do that over and over and over again and see sides of ourselves. So when I've coached people who've played a role before or revisiting a role, they actually feel that their life has changed since the last time they played that. So they might have kids now, or maybe their parent died, or maybe their husband died, or their wife, and they come at the role a whole nother way because their hearts are in a different place. And it's kind of wonderful because Shakespeare gives them the chance to go back and play again, and they don't have to play it the same way, or nor would they want to. A lot of them are like, oh, if only I could do it again, because now I know more.
Kevin did two Hamlets at the Public, you know?
Yep.
You know, not so far apart.
Right. Great. Yes.
Come on down.
Robin. Great. So Robin, you have okay,
Olivia.
From 12th Night. Let's do it. This is our first comedy of the evening, right? Yes.
What is your parentage? Above my fortunes, yet my state is well. I am a gentleman. I'll be sworn thou art. Thy tongue, thy face, thy limbs, actions, and spirit do give thee fivefold blazon. Not too fast, soft, soft. Unless the master were the man. How now, even so quickly, one may catch the plague? Methinks I feel this youth's perfections with an invisible and subtle stealth to creep in at mine eyes. Well, let it be. What ho, Malvolio! Run after that same peevish messenger, the county's man. He left this ring behind him, would I or not. Tell him I'll none of it. Desire him not to flatter with his lord, nor hold him up with hopes. I am not for him, if but the youth will come again tomorrow. I'll give him reason for it. Hi thee, Malvolio! I do. I know not what, but fear to find mine eye too great a flatterer for my mind. Fate, show thy force. Ourselves we do not owe. What is decreed must be. And be this so.
Robin, join us here. Nice. I think we're coming on. Yep.
So what was going on for you differently when you were talking to Malvolio than when you were figuring out the problem with Cesario? You know, when you were like, oh, wait, what is that? Oh, my God. You know, that's, but then you started to talk to Malvolio, and it was, there was a different thing happening for you. What was going on for you that was different?
He's just such a, I guess once he was actually there and I had somebody to talk to who yeah. I had a relationship with, obviously, and it's a pretty condescending relationship, I guess.
Right.
I became the mistress of the house again, opposite this ridiculous yeah. servant.
The language was clearer for me, mm-hmm. and how you experienced, how you made your way through it was much clearer for me in that point. And so my suggestion would be, in the first part, have a conversation with yourself. Mm. Talk to yourself. And maybe there's silent questions or silent answers that prompt the next thing, but you're actually having a conversation with yourself. Because I felt like you felt, again, like there was emotional high bar to reach, and you're like, oh my God, I have to be really excited about this. And I wonder if maybe there's a build to that excitement, to fivefold blazon, rather than just like, bah! Out of the gate, you know? And it felt like it was, I felt like it was a little pushed in the beginning, and I don't think it's necessary.
Okay.
Well, my question would be, is this the first time she's ever felt Twitter-pated?
Felt what?
Like Twitter-pated? Is that an outdated word?
No.
Excited? Like,
yeah.
By seeing a man? So could there be the shock value of the first line, you know?
Yeah.
That you actually don't know what that feeling is?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So oh, yeah. That perhaps is an opening. It would tone it down a little bit, but also still have the comedy that you want, the playing that you want, of this is very unfamiliar, you know, kind of an uncomfortable kind of thing going on. And then she realizes it's a ride, you know. But I definitely think it's nice to have the two voices between discussing with the audience this feeling and then the Malvolio coming in. And you just, like you said, what is it that you boss him around or, yeah. So I think if you explore those two different parts, what you share with the audience and then what you share with him, where you put the mask on, I think that would be funnier,
right.
as directors like to say, what's funnier?
Yeah.
Could be, I don't know.
Yeah, it's a great audition piece, just in terms of the fact that A, the character's really joyful and that's fun to watch, and B, the sort of, the strong variety is built into it in terms of how you're acting privately and how you're acting in front of Malvolio. So as an audition piece, I think, like, well-curated.
Thank you.
I think, sorry.
No.
You know, you say, methinks I feel this youth's perfections, whatever that line is. You know, and I think that you really have to, you know, if we suit the action to the word to the action, you really have to be thinking. You really have to be like, whoa, what is this? I think this is what I'm feeling. And kind of think your way through each thing until it kind of gets you.
Actually, that's a funny idea, because if it bubbles, and then you got to call him in. Mm-hmm. You know, you could have that, not the bubbling until right before he has to come into the room.
Right.
And then you have to tone it down.
Yeah.
And that would give you another laugh, I think.
Can we try the first part up to Malvolio's entrance again?
Yeah.
Oh, and one more note. Don't cover your face. Please
okay.
Don't cover your face.
Okay.
Okay.
Breathe.
What is your parentage? above my fortunes, yet my state is well. I am a gentleman. I'll be sworn thou art.
thy tongue, thy face, thy limbs, thy actions and spirit do give thee fivefold blazon. Not too fast, soft, soft. Unless the master were the man. How now? Even so quickly one may catch the plague? Methinks I feel this youth's perfections with an invisible and subtle stealth to creep in at mine eyes. Well, let it be.
Yeah, yeah, nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that felt certainly much less pushed and sort of more discovered in the moment, which is really, really nice. There's other little clues in there. I feel like you need to tell yourself not so fast. I feel like that's a clue to sort of, you know, really be like driving up until that point. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? And there's a really great useful antithesis right when the argument turns there, like, oh, unless the master were the man. So I think you can really like set those ideas in opposition to each other, because that's what she sort of, that's the possibility that sort of, you know, that's turned her at that moment.
And I think there's a joke with the limbs. Like, there's something about her measuring how tall he is, or there's something kind of funny about the body parts that she kind of goes over. Yeah. Because girls never do that.
Robin, what's the first to these two questions, or the question and then the statement? What is your parentage? Above my fortunes, yet my state as well. I'm a gentleman. Three statements. What's that about for you?
So he makes this whole sort of overture of love to me, mm-hmm. and the only thing I say is, "What is your parentage?" And it's like, oh God, of all the things to say, what a stupid thing to say. So I guess that's sort of the state that she starts in.
Yeah, but what's interesting to me is that she starts in that place, and I totally agree. But then she repeats what he says,
right?
Which I think is kind of what leads us into this moment that Tom was talking about, that sort of, I think she gets Scooby-Doo eyes for him really quickly, right? Okay, like, she's like, wow, you know, like she's, you're really playing that. There's something interesting here about her repeating what he says, mm-hmm. and I don't really know why she does that for sure, but it's something that, like, as an actor, I would want to investigate. I mean, she's repeating the conversation, but there's a reason why his words resonate for her. And so maybe as you continue to work on this, it's sort of making a really strong choice, because then I think it might take you into the pace that Tom is talking about with the beginning.
Well, it's a bit of a riddle, right? I mean, he says it as a riddle.
Yeah.
Like, what does that mean? Let me figure that out.
Yeah.
I feel it's not like a normal answer.
Right. Yeah. And I feel like she'll be repeating it to herself, like, as she goes to sleep tonight, you know? Like,
yes.
She's just kind of reliving this.
Totally.
Oh, my God.
The mystery is really alluring, sort of the way he speaks and uses language is part of what's so hot about him. And I think the next thing you notice or sort of remark about him is his tongue, which is, you know, I mean, obviously, from what you know, it's just how he uses it in speech. But that's what sort of captured her imagination, you know, among the other attributes that you list. But that seems to be high on the list.
Yeah. Yes. Robin, thank you
so
much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It was great.
Thank you.
Great to end with the comedy. Okay.
Everybody loves Olivia. I mean, she just brightens the room, doesn't she?
It's a great monologue. It is. It's great. It's these. So let's.
Well, we're on Twelfth Night.
Yes.
Never in an audition do Viola's ring speech. It's so over and over. You see like 20 of them in a day if you're seeing 50 of them. Just a little word of advice.
Yes. Well played. Wrapping up, first of all, thank you to our four colleagues who did this for us this evening. Thank you so much. Really appreciate it. Your work really helped keep the conversation moving forward, because you gave us something to respond to, so we really appreciate that, so thank you. Last sort of parting pieces of advice that you have for people as they tackle these speeches,
tackle these speeches in audition, in performance. Any last pieces of advice that you'd like to share?
I would say prepare a lot and don't be afraid of technique. It won't stifle you, it will set you free. So if you don't feel like you have like a few things that you always do or tend to do when you start to work on something, ask someone or you know read somewhere what those things might be, because they are so useful. And it's almost impossible to do a great Shakespeare play like just based on instinct. And the normal sort of tools that will get you through something really contemporary. Because you need those, and you'll want to bring those, but there are things that are specific to the language that just you almost can't do without.
Yep.
I have to agree with Tom exactly that, you know, this it was written in a specific way to avoid the rhetorical structure is to not do Shakespeare. Don't avoid it. Embrace it. Make it part of what you're doing. And then have fun. You know, sometimes I like to think that sometimes auditions are the only acting I get to do. So I really want to enjoy it when I'm doing it.
Melinda. Yeah, I agree. Just follow what's in the monologue, follow in the piece, look at the grammatical devices. And if you're unclear, ask someone to help you. Don't just stumble in there without working with someone who knows something. And aim high. Make your, you know, have big goals and keep going. You know, don't give up. Just go, go, go. Find people who know more than you do and suck up to them or whatever it takes to teach you and to get you to the next level. And if you're in a class where you're the top, you need to go to a better class that you're not the top so you learn more. So go out there and nail it. Nail it.
Know what you're saying.
And mean what you say.
And read the play.
Yeah.
Read the play. Read the play. Know what you're saying, because the play is going to inform the rest of the, you know, the monologue. You got to know what you're talking about. And you're going to be asked questions about, you know, the character, and say, oh, I just learned the monologue. I didn't read the play.
Yeah, I'd also dissuade people from just pulling off a monologue off the internet with no notes. I hope no one here does that. I wouldn't think anyone here would do that. But, you know, there's a wonderful book Ben and David Crystal wrote called Shakespeare's Words that basically lists most of the words that's found in the canon. It's a great resource. I'd highly recommend it if you don't already have it. Then have that as your go-to place when you don't know what a word means.
I would just offer two pieces of advice. Punctuation, I think, is very important. One of the actors talked about the musicality that her musical sort of background helped her with this speech. And I think that playwrights put punctuation marks in like composers put punctuation marks in. I know we can contest the punctuation marks in some of these versions of the plays, but you know, hopefully the editors that are editing these plays are doing their homework and placing the end marks in the right place. I think they give a lot of clues about thoughts. And then the only other thing that I often say is, I look at a speech sometime as a director when I'm working on a play, and I do not know what it means. Okay, I'm not sure of its meaning. The actor is incredibly helpful in that moment to me because they actually start to embody it and move it around. But a question that's been useful for me is rather, what does the speech mean? I ask, what is the speech doing? Is it an argument? Is it a declaration of love? Is it a list of things that a servant is giving to someone? What is the speech doing? And that's in Brian and York's A Shakespearean Actor Prepares is a text that I like to use quite a bit. What is the speech doing? And I feel like we've been talking about that a lot in here this evening as we've been looking at these speeches. And so it's just a very simple question that I keep in my mind all the time, particularly when I don't understand the speech. So if I don't literally understand the meaning, sometimes even before I look up the words, I try to figure out what it's doing, because that helps me then discover the meaning by understanding the action of it, which we've talked about with verbs, we've talked about with understanding where it is in the play, all those pieces. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you for having
thanks,
us
SAG.
This evening, and thank you all for being here as well. Have a good rest of your night.